Good morning once again. Today I have the honor of introducing our keynote speaker, Dr. Travis Stork. Dr. Stork is an Emmy-nominated host of the award-winning show, The Doctors. He's a board-certified emergency physician. Dr. Stork graduated magna cum laude from Duke University. Go Devils. There we go. He earned a Doctor of Medicine degree with honors from the University of Virginia. Dr. Stork is also a New York Times best-selling author, 5 books and counting. And some of you might know him from a little TV show that he did on ABC called The Bachelor. Some women are nodding their heads. Today is also a very special day because he's joining us on his birthday. He's a hard worker. So please join me in welcoming to the stage our keynote speaker, Dr. Travis Stork.
Best-selling author and host of the daytime show, The Doctors, Dr. Travis Stork. Well, Dr. Travis Stork is joining me today.
Dr. Stork, you have a call on line one.
So this is a level one trauma. Patient apparently fell.
What's your name, sir? We'll be your toes, my friend.
Doctor, give me the news.
Hey, everyone, welcome to The Doctors.
It's really cold.
Snakes are my one phobia. Does this cheese melt on a sandwich, but then burn when you light it? If we actually look through every tissue in the body, this is a healthy set of lungs. This is someone who smoked their whole life. Obesity over time can build up plaque deposits in your arteries. If that ruptures, it can lead to a fatal heart attack.
You're still scared, and I think that highlights this idea of how many, yes, physical scars you have, but the emotional scars.
We all have different lifespans. Some of us live 10 years, some of us live 90 years, but every life on this earth is a blessing. You've inspired me so much. I brought my own helmet because I'm gonna do the ride with you.
Ready? We are at the start finish. 100 miles, here we come. Got this, Lauren.
I'm taking care of a really young girl. The building actually collapsed. It crushed her right lower extremity. The wound is so extensive that she's gonna need an amputation. You know, it's a day in the life. You never know what you're gonna see. But the one thing I can say, it's never boring. And in the end, I feel like this is what I was meant to do.
Hello, everyone. Thanks so much for that introduction, Harold, and go Devils. I have to throw that out there. Big game tonight. But I'm so happy to be here with you all today, and I want this talk to be personal. And what I mean by that is most of you are here because in one way, shape, or form, you have a connection to the produce industry. But this slide, that comes from my heart and soul, because as a doctor, as someone who's seen so very much in my life, I truly believe what this slide says, which is food is the best medicine. And it's so very important for me to be here today because this has become my passion in life, spreading these messages of good health. And what I love about this audience is, number one, it's a packed house, but you know what I don't see out there? I'm looking for it, but what do I not see? There is no inflammation. That anti-inflammatory lunch, how does everyone feel? I walked through and I saw that buffet and I loved it because every single thing on that buffet table served a purpose. So before I get into the meat of my speech, I first of all want to say happy 20th anniversary to the Southeast Produce Council. Today also happens to be my birthday. Thank you. And anyone else, March 9th birthday out there? Happy birthday. Happy birthday to the March 9thers. But I don't bring that up because we're here to celebrate my birthday. That is not why we are here. But the picture you're seeing is actually the picture of me on my 9th birthday, 38 years ago. Only time I ever took a plane in my whole childhood, I flew down here for my 9th birthday, and that's me with my sister. You can see I was a huge fan. And as I thought about coming here on my 47th birthday, I was a little bit in awe because I went back and I asked my mom, do you have any pictures from that trip? And it made me think about how that little kid in a million years never would have thought that he would be on a stage as a doctor talking about health, talking about food as your medicine, because I did not grow up in a space where this would be expected. My parents come from Iowa, Nebraska, farmers. I grew up born in Fort Collins, Colorado, lived in Broomfield, Colorado, Wichita, Kansas, Edmond, Oklahoma, Chesterfield, Missouri. I didn't know anything about health. I didn't have any doctors in my family. In fact, I went to college for some random reason. I was really good at math, so I studied math in college, and I became an actuarial scientist after college. So the quiz, anyone out there know what an actuarial scientist does? Okay, we have one person who... What does an actuarial scientist do? They study trends and they forecast the future. So what I did as an actuarial scientist in Washington, D.C. out of college is, I'm going to switch the slides here because this is what I ended up becoming, but I studied essentially how long people were expected to live. And in actuarial science, you're looking at demographics and you're saying, okay, well, this population is going to live so long, and so if it's a life insurance policy or a benefit plan. And it was so abstract for me, and it's just ironic because it was a number. I didn't really think about the individuals that I was plugging into computer programs to determine when they might die. After a while, I realized that this... Although I actually really enjoyed the profession, this wasn't my calling. And I found my calling in a random way. I started volunteering at a place called the Washington Free Clinic. And it was a free health clinic at the top of a church, or there was this balcony floor of a church downtown DC. And I started volunteering there despite no history in medicine. And they threw me in the back. And they put me in the lab, and they started bringing back urine samples and said, okay, Travis, you're in charge of the urine. And you know how the specimen containers are sitting there, and a couple line up. I don't know what I'm doing. I don't even know to wear gloves. So I'm dipping urine strips in. They're coming out. Urine's dripping everywhere. That's how I got my start, because I kept going back. And every time I went back, I looked at the physicians who were volunteering their time there, and I developed such awe for them and what they were doing, because they were connected. Those numbers that were abstract to me about when people were gonna die, I was seeing it here front and center, and I was seeing these doctors give diligent care to these patients. And then they invited me up front one day to start taking vital signs. And the first time I took someone's blood pressure, something changed in me, because that authentic interaction was so very special. So I had a complete career change, and at night I would go back to college, take classes in at Georgetown and George Mason so I could go to medical school. And then fast forward, it took a while, meaning I had to go to medical school and all that stuff. But I went to University of Virginia Medical School, and then I fell in love with something in particular, and that was emergency medicine. And I loved it because I am a bit of an adrenaline junkie. And anyone who's ever been in an emergency department, and probably most everyone in here sadly has been, it is a crazy environment, but there's also a lot of excitement in there. When you're a doctor, you can see a two-week-old baby or a 95-year-old grandparent or great-grandparent all in the course of 5 minutes. And the amount of illness and sickness you see, the chaos. I actually enjoyed it. And when I first went into emergency medicine, the thing I loved the most, and this may sound incredibly morbid, but when a really sick patient came in, that's when I thrived the most. Because I felt like that was my calling. Let's save this person's life. And I took a vow to be the best ER doc I could possibly be. And I took pride in that. I'm very proud of what we're able to do in the emergency department, but what I will say, and why I'm happy to be on this stage here with you all today, is that over time, you know, those first few years when someone would come in really sick, maybe they were having a really devastating heart attack. And yeah, there were plenty of times where I might save a life, so to speak, but a lot of my patients were never really getting better. And so a lot of times I felt like really what I was doing was putting a Band-Aid. I wasn't necessarily fixing a problem, but I was. I was helping temporarily provide a solution. And over time I began to realize that the hardest part about being an ER doctor is not all of the chaos, it's not the procedures. The hardest part is telling a family member that they've lost a loved one far too soon with an illness that could have been prevented. And right then and there, I began to shift. So I still love emergency medicine. I still love taking care of a problem after it happens. But now my passion is preventing illness before it starts. And what's really interesting is, in that vein, I have to, at times, even condemn our own healthcare industry. And so I'm going to throw out a few statistics. And trust me, by the end of this talk, you will understand that I very much appreciate our healthcare system, my peers. But if you all had to guess the percentage of healthcare that we receive that provides no benefit, what would you guess? What percent? 60? 35%. Estimates are about a third of healthcare provides no benefit. You said 60%, 33%, a third. I think that a third is a gross underestimate. I had that slide at the beginning of the presentation say food is your best medicine. And it doesn't mean that prescription medicines aren't necessary. But behind heart disease and cancer, what is the third most common cause of death in our country? Suicide is a big one nowadays, sadly, but it's prescription drugs and unexpected medical errors. And this all ties back to the point of my speech, which is not that prescription drugs don't save lives, they do. But they also come with incredibly untoward side effects. And so when I tell people food is your medicine, you know, the last time I checked when I had a bowl of berries, I didn't worry about too many side effects, maybe better complexion, things along those lines. But that's what I tell people now. Healthcare is essential, and that's a big part of who I still am. But we all, each and every one of us, has so much more power when it comes to our health, and it really does start with our food. So even if you don't have a pen and paper, I want everyone, when they leave this room here today, to commit to doing three new things in their lives. Because every single day, we make hundreds of seemingly inconsequential health decisions that dictate how well and how long we live. And interestingly, most of those choices do revolve around food. And in that vein, if we're gonna let food help us, the first thing that I've learned in my own life and that I tell my patients and I tell the viewers who watch the doctors, I say, if we're gonna make food be something good for us, let's first step, it can't be our poison. And I think everyone in this room would probably agree that we have a tendency at times, particularly in America, a lot of the food we eat is very highly processed. A lot of times it's refined, meaning all those good ingredients like whole grain bread, the whole grains will be stripped and all the fiber, everything's taken out. And the more highly processed a food is, the riskier it is for us to eat. And so when you talk about food as your poison, a lot of times I tell people, if I take a food item off the shelf at a grocery store and I flip it over and I cannot pronounce an ingredient, I put it back. And I hope everyone in this room realizes the power of real food. And the more we can prevent sort of these untoward consequences of food and shift our behavior towards the positive consequences, the better off we'll be. So I mentioned being an adrenaline junkie. Apparently I'm also not very smart, because a few years ago, the producers of our show convinced me to engage in something called Project Unhealthy. They said, Dr. Travis, this is all we want you to do. You're not allowed to exercise for a week. Every single meal, eat just the food you really want to eat. Maybe the food you don't normally eat, but we want you to eat donuts and fast food. Do all the things that you tell people not to do regularly. We all should indulge from time to time, by the way. So I did it. So the very first morning, I roll into the local donut shop. And I think I got a half dozen. And that first donut, I believe it was one of those chocolate eclairs. And once it hit my taste buds, you know what happened? Wonderful things. I had fast food for lunch, same thing. So what was happening as you look at this video, these fats and sugars and salts were hitting my taste buds, getting in my belly. And it was delicious. Absolutely delicious. So what happens when I eat a meal like that is my pleasure centers in my brain. You see that's my dopamine going hog wild, telling me, Travis, this is the best day of your life. And I love Project Unhealthy. Day two, I kept loving it. But something was happening physiologically. What you see there, those green dots represent insulin. That white crystal, that is sugar. I was eating so much sugar, causing such massive spikes in my insulin, that what your body tells you to do in that case is store that fat, in particular in your belly. That's called visceral belly fat. The problem is that visceral belly fat, as those fat cells get bigger and multiply, they act, I call it toxic goop because it's biochemically active. And they release all these pro-inflammatory biomarkers, unlike your lunch today, releasing things like cortisol. Cortisol causes your heart rate to go up, your blood pressure to go up. And cortisol is also, believe it or not, a chronic stress hormone. So by about day three, all I cared about in life was my next hit. By day six, I threw my back out, I got on the scale, and in 6 days I put on 8 pounds, took my blood pressure, and I had gone into the hypertensive range. So I told the producers, I can't even make it to day seven. And I tell that story for one reason and one reason only, and that is because we are supposed to indulge from time to time because the foods we love are our treats. But I actually believe in my heart and soul that we live in a time, the glass is half full, we have never had more options for healthy foods. And I tell people all the time, this doesn't mean when you're eating healthy and letting food be your medicine, it's not twigs and berries 24/7. We have so many great options. Everyone in this room knows that there are so many wonderful ways to make wonderful foods where food truly can be our medicine. When you start looking at populations out there and you ask yourself, what is the best diet? You may completely disagree with everyone else at your table, and what you eat may work for you. And each and every one of us in this room may have a slightly different diet that works for us. And there's a lot of confusion out there, but when you look at this busy slide, which you're never supposed to show in a presentation, but there is an area I want you to focus on. These are three blue zones: Okinawa, Japan, Loma Linda, California, and Sardinia, Italy. And these are various things that these cultures engage in. And then that little middle area is where they basically match. And what's right in the middle there? Plant-based. Every single culture in the world where people have the most, live the longest, they have the highest percentage of centenarians. The way they eat differs slightly here and there, but the amount of fresh produce that they eat is so far above what the rest of us eat, and the way they make their meals is different. So I tell people all the time, when they're shocked to hear that Italy has a community where people live to be 100 all the time. How can that be? They eat pasta every meal. Well, you know how they eat their pasta. They'll serve about 2 ounces of pasta al dente, and then everything else on that plate with the pasta, it's all mixed in with wonderful vegetables, all the colors of the rainbow. And then instead of putting some Franken sauce on it, with ingredients you can't pronounce, they douse it with olive oil and fresh herbs and black pepper. You know, and all these things play a role. Black pepper has piperine and it increases your metabolism. All these spices that they use are anti-inflammatory, and the list goes on and on. And that's why they have such low rates of heart disease and cancer. And so whatever diet I tell people they want to embark on, and when I say diet, I mean lifelong diet, produce, fresh fruits and vegetables has to be at the center of it, and it doesn't have to be boring. And that is something I tell people all the time. People think they get good health by going to see the doctor. And that's, as a doctor, I'm going to tell you that's not true. We serve an important purpose, but good health happens in between doctor's visits. You know where good health starts? The grocery store. I tell people, you go in that grocery store, you're walking into a pharmacy. And it's awesome. Have fun. Enjoy it. I tell people, you go in the grocery store, start in the periphery, because that's where all the fresh produce is. When I see a banana, I don't have to flip it over and read the ingredients list, right? It's a banana. It may be a little riper or not ripe, but I don't have to look and read ingredients list. So I tell people, fill that shopping cart with all those wonderful foods, those colors of the rainbow. And then you go into the middle aisles and get the few things you need here and there to fill up the rest of your basket. But that decision alone, seemingly inconsequential, could add years and years to everyone's life. Because the problem is most of us go right down the center aisle and we fill the grocery cart up with all the processed foods, and there's very little room left sometimes for the good stuff. So when you talk about produce, when you talk about fruits and vegetables, everybody in the world knows you're supposed to eat more fruits and vegetables, right? I've been hearing that since I was a little kid. That, in fact, that same little kid I showed you before, I used to sit at the table for about 2 hours after my meal because I refused to eat my broccoli. Luckily, I'm still a little kid inside, so I've learned ways to make that broccoli where it's a lot better than just sitting there all by itself. But when I look at this apple, I can tell you what I see. But when you all look at this apple, what do you see? And what color is it? A little green in there? What I see when I look at this apple is I see bright, vivacious reds, some greens. And those are phytochemicals. And I know you all have had some talks about this already this week, but those are phytochemical antioxidants that do wonderful things in our human bodies. And that could be a picture of broccoli. It could be a picture of any fruit or vegetable. And what's really cool is the symphony of all of these foods together are what's so essential. We live in a time where people want to take a pill to be healthy. They want to take a supplement. If one food is good for me, well, wouldn't it be better to put it in a pill? And I say no. It's almost like saying if you have a symphony and you decide that you're going to take one particular supplement in really high doses, that's like taking a symphony and you add 500 violins. All of a sudden, the symphony doesn't work quite right. And that's why when I look at this apple and I see all the potential health benefits, I see those phytochemicals, those antioxidants, those anti-inflammatory compounds. The other thing I see is fiber. I'm sorry for giving the quizzes. I'm a math nerd. What percentage of people in America get enough protein? Greater than 90% or less than 90%? Way greater than 90%. 97%+ of us get enough protein. You know how the percentage of us that get enough fiber? It's estimated that less than 5% of people in America get enough fiber. And yet all the marketing tells you you need more protein, more protein, more protein. I tell people all the time, no, no, no. We need more fiber. Because fiber does so many things in the human body. As an ER doc, first of all, I have to take a moment. When you think of fiber, you might think of Metamucil, right? When you think of fiber, you might think of constipation. We have a constipation crisis in America, folks. I can't even begin to tell you how many times I take care of patients with abdominal pain in the ER and it's constipation. Because when less than 5% of your population is eating enough fiber, things get backed up because fiber does wonderful things. And I'll go through, keeps you regular. Being regular is a wonderful thing in life. I'm not just a doctor, I'm also a participant. I'm a human. But fiber grabs onto cholesterol. It is a natural anti-cholesterol medicine. In Britain, they did a study. People ate an apple a day or they took a statin. And statins, FYI, are an important drug, and those who take them should. But what's really cool in this study is the people who ate an apple a day lowered their risk of heart disease the same amount as those taking the statin. So there's a compound effect here. And that's kind of where the symphony of modern medicine and food as medicine comes together. And a lot of that's due to fiber. But interestingly, my last book, I wrote all about the gut microbiome. And I think you all may have talked about that earlier. I shouldn't say earlier this week, but later this week. These fiber compounds are prebiotics. So what they do is we don't digest them. They go through our GI tract. And you know what happens? Our gut bacteria, they have a party. They have a feast on this fiber. And the reason that's important is we're learning so much now that we have DNA sequencing about the importance of these gut bacteria. Lean people have 70% more gut bacteria. They have more diverse species. Well, in our country, when fewer than 5% of us are getting enough of this fiber, you know what else is suffering? Our good gut bacteria. And when you put this whole picture together, I tell people, stop looking at fruits and vegetables and fresh produce as something that you have to do. It's something you should be excited to do each and every day. And you don't have to nerd out like I do and get into all those elements. But when I look at this, there was a recent Time article that said maybe food is the best medicine of all. It proffered out that question. And I thought, how great is it that now people are finally starting to realize that lifestyle is the most important medicine of all. And when you talk about blueberries as an example, recent study, people who ate blueberries, 20% lower risk of cardiovascular disease. They were all able to naturally lower their blood pressure too. And again, it gets back to phytochemicals, fiber, list goes on and on again. That could be a picture of anything from the fresh produce aisle. And when you start to look at fruits and vegetables, it's not just our gut. It's also our mind. A recent study in the journal Neurology, and think about this for a minute, dementia has become a major problem in our country. People who regularly munched on fruits and veggies lowered their risk of cognitive decline by 30%. And we don't have great treatments for dementia, but if I told you I could give you a pill that could lower your risk of cognitive decline by 30%, you'd take it every day. No question. In a study in Australia, what was really cool is people who increased their intake of produce, it wasn't about dementia. You know what it was? Their psychological well-being was improved. They were actually happier. It seems too good to be true, but it's not. And that's the beauty of this concept. When I tell people food is your medicine, with very few side effects. Obviously, you don't want to eat foods you're allergic to. No. That is not your medicine. That is food is your poison. But if food is our medicine, is the most important lesson I've learned. I don't let food be my poison. I let it be my medicine. I still have treats. I still indulge. So if anyone sees me eating fries and a burger later, do not judge me. Because I'm the CEO of my own health. And you all are too. Most important job you'll ever have. Because when you go to bed at night and you think about the most important thing in your life, it's probably your family. And what I've learned as an ER doc in life is when you don't have your health, it's really hard to be a good father or mother or parent, grandparent, son, daughter. And we have so much control, but I'll admit it, our healthcare system does this. I know when I went into healthcare, the system was much more paternalistic. People felt like healthcare happened to them, not with them. But since you all are the CEO of your health, Find a good primary care doctor that you trust, that appreciates and values you and the decisions you make. Because healthcare is important. This is a gentleman who his whole life had high blood pressure. You can make every decision right, and you can still get cancer, heart disease. In this case, he ended up with kidney failure and came to the ER with a shunt malfunction because of a clotting problem. And he needed healthcare. When you're the CEO of your own health, yeah, you're gonna make better food choices, but other little things matter too. I talked about hundreds of decisions we make every day that affect how long and how well we live. You know, sometimes it's as simple as taking a deep breath. We live in a time where we're incredibly stressed out. So many deadlines, so many messages, it seems like we can't escape. So this is one of the things I do in my life every day, and a mentor of mine taught me this in the ER. I ran my first code, and the whole time, my mind was racing. And he said, look, when you're coding a patient, just take a deep breath. And I thought that was terrible advice. Why would I take a few seconds to take a deep breath? And he explained to me that in those moments where you take that deep breath, you're gonna take command of that room, and you're gonna take command of your patient's life and help save them. Try it sometime. The next time you whether it's your kids, whether it's work, just take a deep breath, count 5 seconds, hold it for 2 seconds, and release for 5 seconds. These activities alone can lower your blood pressure and lower your risk of cardiovascular disease. And what's really cool is when you can help lower your stress levels, and whether it's active meditation, yoga, all the things you can do, these all come together to create what I call this virtuous cycle of good health. You're eating better. You're actively figuring out ways to try to reduce stress in your life. If you can't get to the gym every day, don't stress out. We don't stress anymore. I worry more about what do you do those other 23 hours in the day. An hour in the gym is great, but what are you doing the other 23 hours? Even people who go 20 minutes a day outside have 20% more energy, improved moods. And when you have an improved mood and you're, again, treating your health as a priority, you're a CEO of your own health, what's interesting, you're eating better, you're more regular, you start sleeping better. And people who sleep better, interestingly, they live longer lives. People who are underslept, actually, there's studies now that their leptin and ghrelin, which are hunger hormones, get out of whack, and people who do not get as good of sleep or as long of sleep often end up with weight issues because of it. And before I take a few questions, because we have about 10 minutes when I finish here for a couple of questions, but I am not getting in the way of the cake cutting. This is meant, and I mean this from my heart and soul, it's meant to be fun. Health should be your hobby. It should be something that you really get a kick out of. And when it becomes a hobby, all of a sudden your friends, wait a minute. You know, when we went over to David's house and had that really great meal where they had all those vegetables in with just that little bit of pasta, that whole wheat pasta, that was wonderful. All of a sudden, everyone joins in. I truly believe that's where we're at in our country. If we make health our hobby and we make better decisions, we'll all be healthy together. We'll live longer lives. And my hope in coming here today is, again, everyone here is in an industry that plays a vital role in the health of people all over the world. But one of the things I've had to be reminded of over the last 15 years as my life has gotten busier is I try to take to heart the things I learn and utilize them in my own life as well. So make health your hobby, and as you do so, inspire others to do the same. Thank you all so very much for having me. And like I said, I have about 10 minutes for questions. And there are a couple handheld mics out there. So if anyone has a question, just raise your hand and they'll bring a microphone to you. And if no one has questions, hopefully that means I did my job.
Many of us are from rural America where there's not enough capacity for healthcare. We know every doctor, nurse, dentist, psychiatrist we know is working more. What are they doing, say, at a medical training and medical licensing to get the guys we need for the vets and the psychiatric problems especially, but all the health care that we need.
That is a very unfortunate problem in healthcare in America, and a lot of that is because healthcare is driven primarily by the almighty dollar. And that's just an honest physician in front of you. Healthcare has been taken over by corporate America, and rural medicine is not a very profitable area of medicine. I think where people are starting to realize the benefit of reaching more patients in rural communities is the use of telemedicine. And I think you're going to see a continued growth in that. Obviously, there are scholarship programs. Where I went to medical school, there were scholarship programs for doctors who agreed to go work for 10 years. And a lot of schools have that, which is wonderful. But the reality is that you're never going to see in rural communities these big 20-floor hospitals. The biggest thing for me is my very first shift as an ER doctor was at a critical access hospital in Macon County, Tennessee, a 25-bed hospital. And honestly, my fondest memories as a doctor came in that community. So it's a problem that isn't going away, but I will say, technologically speaking, telemedicine, I think, is going to bring, when it comes to psychiatry help, something you can use via that platform. I see a lot of potential in that regard. Anyone else? All right. Wait, here we go.
Some of the top medical schools in the U.S. are doing college or class. Mm-hmm. Do you see that spreading out and expanding?
So the question is, certain medical schools are now teaching doctors culinary classes and skills. I do see it expanding. And not only that, a lot of you may not have heard of it. There's a new field of medicine called lifestyle medicine. And unfortunately, medicine moves very slowly. And a lot of doctors, even when I used to take resident physicians, and I've commuted back to LA from Nashville for over a decade, and I would come back to Nashville and I would share some of the recent data I'd read about, whether it be food or other treatments, and there's some pushback, but I see the culinary classes, I see it all expanding, because what's really cool is you're seeing the younger generation that goes into medicine. They get it. When I went to med school, I had a 4-hour class on nutrition one morning, and that was it. And it wasn't a very good class. And it's just me speaking from the heart. I had to teach it all to myself. We have a question over here. If you shout it all, repeat it. What is my take on CBD? I personally am very hopeful. And just to clarify, I was born in Colorado where THC is legal. THC is the psychoactive part of marijuana, the Cheech and Chong part. CBD, cannabidiol, is non-psychoactive. And we have this endocannabinoid system in our body. And there's actually some really compelling evidence that CBD, the way it interacts with our endocannabinoid system, without giving anyone a high, can decrease inflammation in the body. And there's some good studies. More research needs to be done, but with chronic pain, you know, with children and seizures, there's actually a formal drug approved now. And I am personally a big proponent of letting this take it where it may, because for me, we're always fearful of things we don't know, and that's for good reason. And even my good friends in medicine still, quite frankly, in Tennessee, most of them don't understand the difference between CBD and THC. So when I explain, CBD doesn't cause you to get high. But a lot of you may not realize that when you pop an ibuprofen, if you pop too much of it, you're putting yourself at risk for not only gastric ulcers, but kidney disease. I've taken care of plenty of patients who accidentally overdosed on acetaminophen, which is a drug that is found in a lot of pain medications, and if you're not feeling well and you start stacking these, you can very, very quickly get to a toxic dose. And so what I'm all for as a doctor is treatments that provide the best benefit with the least amount of harm. And I think there's more to come on the CBD front. All right, we have, if there's one more question, we got time for it.
So this is a couple comments. One of them, I want to endorse what you're saying. I was at UMass Medical School in the 1990s, and we taught the medical students there in 8,000 contact hours, 4 hours. We did a good job, but it was only 4 hours. And the other thing I wanted to mention, further to the study that you mentioned in England, in the 1990s, we showed that a dietitian-led program as part of a randomized trial reduced serum cholesterol in hyperlipidemic patients the same amount as statins. It was published in Archives of Internal Medicine in 99 and then Journal of the American Dietetic Association also in 99.
And you can't argue with that data. Thank you for sharing that. And as doctors, when you start hearing about lowering cholesterol and lipids in the blood naturally, it just gets us so excited because medicines, again, if your doctor has you on a medicine, always ask the question, why am I on it? And if the answer is this is why and you need to be on it, then you should take it. But always, always ask your doctor, are there alternatives? Is there anything I can do to potentially avoid this medication? Because take it from an ER doctor, there are a lot of untoward side effects. And there have been nights in the ER where 50% of my patients are there because of some side effect of the 15 to 20 medications that they're on. So just never lose sight of that. And just remember, I'm very, very excited to be here mainly because it's great for me. I was flipping through the newspaper magazine that were left at my doorstep this morning. It was just really cool for me to go through because in modern society, I always see advertisements for all of these miracle cures. And my job is difficult because it is not sexy or cool to say, eat more produce, right? It's hard at times because people look at you and they say, well, wait a minute, Dr. Stork, what about this fancy new pill they're selling for $5 each? So the more that we talk about it and spread this message, the more that we actually can have an effect on consumers' behavior, because everyone in this room, not only in our own lives, but we all have, I think, power to help make a change, and slowly over time, hopefully what you're gonna see is this lifestyle medicine, 10, 20 years from now, that's going to be what is taught in every medical school in America. Yeah, we'll still have medicines. Yes, we're still gonna have ERs. We're still gonna have emergency procedures. But every single doctor in America hopefully is going to talk with their patients and say, you know what, here's a prescription. And they're gonna write every day, tomatoes, blueberries, avocados. The list goes on and on. Thank you all so very much for having me. Enjoy the rest of your stay.